Okay, we ended up chapter 29 last time of what was happening in the last few verses. What was going on?
Leah's children.
Leah's starting to have kids. So Leah is having kids, and who is not having kids?
Rachel,
right? And as far as the relationships, we last chapter we figured out, or we learned how Jacob got his wives. And this, you know, he was working for Laban. He wanted to marry Rachel. And y'all correct me if I get my names wrong, because I always get my names wrong here. don't hesitate to say that's the wrong person. Worked willingly for 7 years for Rachel. Was supposed to get Rachel, and who did he end up getting?
Leah.
Laban substituted Leah. Jacob didn't find out about it until the morning. Little bit of confirmation or consternation or a little argument over that. And then Laban, being kind of the deceitful person that he is, and we're going to see more of that in chapter 30, what did he arrange for in order to give Rachel to Jacob?
Seven more years.
Yeah, he extorted basically 7 more years out of him, right? Didn't make him wait the full 7 years. He had to work for another week, or it was like basically a traditional thing that were, you know, this is Leah's time, and Leah's going to get ripped off on this. She got 7 days to have Jacob to herself. And then he gets to marry Rachel. And the things we're going to read, especially the latter part of 29, when Leah's having children, do you remember one of the things she said there that kind of showed the relationship between her and Jacob, and Jacob and Rachel?
She hated her.
God saw that Leah was hated. We talked about that meaning love less. But something that Leah says. Yeah, she's hoping, again, children were so important, male children were so important, the fact that she's having these male children. In verse 34, she says, when she's having, that's her third son, she goes, now, this time will my husband be joined unto me. So from that, we can kind of infer that Jacob, you know, it already said that he did like or love Rachel more. He probably spent most of his time with her. And Leah wanting to spend time with her. Again, the whole idea, that's why God's wisdom. What did God say? Whenever Christ was asked about marriage, divorce and remarriage in the New Testament, what did he say was the intent from the beginning?
One husband and one wife.
One husband and one wife. Anything beyond that, fraught with issues, fraught with problems. So we're seeing a lot of things in these chapters of sibling rivalry, about jealousy, about favoritism. Jacob and Esau with their mother and father, Jacob now and his wives, and just the problems that stuff causes. So again, with wisdom, hopefully we can kind of figure out some stuff like try to avoid those pitfalls, right? Also pointed out last week that God saw Leah's situation, right? That's why she was having it. The Bible says that's why she was getting to have all these kids. And we pointed out that that God tries to lift up those who are being overlooked, those are being slighted. Don't ever feel when you're being done wrong and you believe that no one else knows what's going on. God knows. God sees it. And of the four kids that Leah had, what do we know that she brought about through one of her children?
Christ.
That's right. The last one that's mentioned in chapter 21, she has Judah. And that is the lineage of Christ. So everybody makes a big deal, not a big deal, but the emphasis seems to be placed on Rachel and the fact that she's going to have Joseph, and that's the main character of the story going kind of forward. But Leah had Judah, who brought about the Savior of the world. So again, God did not overlook Leah and her distress. Anything else about that?
Do you think that God was sympathetic of Leah's situation, that's why he closed Rachel's womb?
I don't know if God was being vindictive. I don't know. God was definitely, I don't know. Does God do stuff like that? There are things that the Bible does point out that the wombs of certain people were closed for certain things, like when
Sarah was
pregnant. Yeah, when Sarah had him, that he had stopped the womb. So that's a possibility. But again, we're not given all the story. So can I imagine if Rachel was being ugly about it, but if God said, you're not going to do that, you're not going to have any kid, that's going to be your punishment for the way you're acting, is that a possibility? Yeah. We're not told that. But we are told that, again, that Leah was being blessed for being slighted.
Well, hers was closed also. If you look, it says that he opened hers.
Yep.
So both were closed, and he opened hers first.
And we're going to read some stuff here in 30 that kind of goes back and forth. And we're going to read Jacob's reaction to the situation when Rachel gets onto him here in the first part of chapter 30. He goes, it's not from me, man. That's his understanding of the situation.
Could be also something with that family. Pretty much Sarah had problems bearing children. Now we're seeing two more members of that same family.
Yeah. Could have been something similar genetic, right? Right. Because I mean, today, then there's people have trouble conceiving and having kids. You go to great lengths to try to do that. Anything else? All right. I need someone to read. Let's read someone link for your reading. So 1 through 13, verses 1 through 13.
And when Rachel saw that she bare Jacob no children, Rachel envied her sister and said unto Jacob, give me children or else I die. Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel, and he said, am I God, said, who hath withheld thee from the fruit of thy womb? And she said, behold, my maid Bilhah, go unto her, and she shall bear upon my knees, and I may also have children by her. And she gave him Bilhah, her handmaid, to wife, and Jacob went unto her. Bilhah conceived, and she bare Jacob a son. Rachel said, God hath judged me, and hath also heard my voice, and hath given me a son. Therefore she called his name Dan. And Bilhah, Rachel's handmaid, conceived again, and bare Jacob a second son. Rachel said, with great wrestlings have I wrestled my sister, and I have prevailed, and she called his name Naphtali. When Leah saw that she had left bearing, she took Zilpah, her maid, and gave it to Jacob, his wife. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a son. Leah said, a troop cometh, and she called his name Gad. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a second son. And Leah had said, happy am I, for the daughters will call me blessed, and she called his name Asher.
Okay. Crazy stuff going on. There's lots of interpersonal wranglings here. So Rachel is to the point now that Leah has had several children, four, and she goes to Jacob and says, if you don't give me a child, I'm going to die. We can't emphasize enough how important it was for the women back then to have children. So important, especially male children. It was a huge thing. And again, she's going to Jacob and telling Jacob this, and Jacob's like, it's out of my hands. Jacob gets mad with her, right? Again, you can bring somebody a problem and be upset about it if that person can do something about it. But Jacob's like, am I God? I can't do this. And what he actually said was, and kind of gets some indication maybe to Cody's question, he goes, am I in God's stead, who has withheld from thee the fruit of thy womb? So Jacob could have just been saying that, or maybe Jacob, you know, again, with the patriarchal system, maybe God, he knew something that God had said, hey, this is not happening now for a reason. So we don't know. Possibilities. But Jacob gets upset with her and says, it's in God's hands, not mine. So again, we're going to see now Rachel is going to do something similar to what Sarah had done, right? She can't have kids. And so now she wants a substitute. Remember we talked about the idea, again, about Laban, again, his nature being kind of stingy. We go back to him, again, correct me on my names. We go back to, Isaac, Rachel, Rebecca. That's why I knew it was Rebecca. When she came to visit, I said, I don't remember Rebecca's name because of the order at class. Rebecca was given maids and nurses and given multiple things. They were given one each last chapter. So they have this one handmaid, and she goes, here you go, take her, have kids by her. And then in verse 3, he uses a unique phrase, and she shall bear upon my knees. Do you know the idea she was trying to convey there? What was she trying to say? I didn't know either, so don't feel bad. In the notes, and kind of doing some research, it's kind of, again, a figure of speech. Huh? Not like begging, but I think it had to do with the birthing process and how like a midwife type of thing. But it was going to be like, it's going to be, she's going to have it, but it's going to be mine. It's kind of like the idea of adoption. We're going to use a surrogate mother, but the child is going to be mine. And so that's the idea here, that where she is going to, again, substitute another woman to bring about her children. flashing back to Sarah again, how did that work out for Sarah? Not good, right? Because as soon as you introduce another woman, what's going to usually happen? More jealousy. The only reason it's probably not brought up here, who is she even more jealous of? Her sister. That's the primary conflict right here, right? And so another woman, you start, when you become irrational, you start making all kind of crazy decisions. She goes, so I'm jealous of my sister, so let me bring in another woman and for my husband to have kids by. Just crazy stuff, but that's where she's at.
One thing, sitting here looking at all this and all the trouble and all the angst that they're going through, God had already provided the path of Christ, as we talked about before, in one of the wives, the first wife.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When we look at it.
So true.
It's just something to note. But anyway.
Yeah. It's, again, whenever Christ was asked about that in New Testament times, he says, all this different marriage relationship stuff happened. God winked at King James Version. You know, God allowed. But from the beginning, it was not so. Never the intent. Again, people always look at God's rules as restrictive. One man, one woman forever. Is that the best course of action? For just general peace here and being, you know, scripturally right? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So the idea of polygamy or multiple divorce and remarriage and all that stuff, again, man looks at it like, I get to do what I want to do, and God says, you're just wrecking yourself. Absolutely wrecking yourself. So again, God's ways are always best.
In verse 1, I always said, when she says, or else I die,
mm-hmm.
I always thought of that as being her despair and grief of not having kids. But now that I'm thinking about Jacob being so much older, she has to have a son to take care of her.
Possible.
Or she will die.
Possible, yeah. That's very possible. It seems from the context, and when you read it, I've always taken it as it was that, because everything's about the relationship with her sister. The jealousy, the envy, and wanting to be seen as superior or get one over. Because when she starts having kids, what does she start naming them? Things that reflect the relationship, not between her and Jacob, but between her and her sister. So, but it could also be the very fact that you're talking about. Jacob was much older than her. Jacob was going to pass. And if she didn't have sons to take care of her, there was no social systems back then. You were on your own. And you think Leah was going to take care of her? Ooh, probably not, because they're not getting along right here. They're not in the best relationship. So that is a possibility. So rolling through, they start having kids, and I'm just going to go through and give you the what the meaning of the kids are. So Rachel, they have the first one, and says in verse 6, God hath judged me, and hath heard my voice, and hath given me a son. Therefore his name shall be called Dan. Dan means vindication. She thought she has been slighted, that God has now answered her prayer for a son, even through a handmaid, so that she feels vindicated by that. Rachel's handmaid gets a kid again. And then and this is where, again, the relationship between the sisters is brought out in verse 8. With great wrestlings have I wrestled with my sister. So, again, flashing back, we're not told everything, but flashing back, you remember why Sarah was so upset with Ishmael when she finally had her son? The insight we're given there, what was Ishmael doing? He was mocking when he was, had the party before him when he was being weaned. He was mocking him, and she goes, oh no, he has to go. She was upset with him before, but now that was it. So again, we get glimpses, wrestling with my sister. It was either all in Rachel's mind, or there was actually things being said back and forth, right?
And I had prevailed.
Yeah. So if I, you know, again, knowing family relationship, you know, being around women for 50 years, is it possible that they were mouthing back and forth to each other? Yeah, it was possible. It was definitely possible. So again, even if it wasn't said, Rachel felt it. And so this is, you know, Rachel against, you know, being said that she's felt like she's wrestling with her sister. It flips back around the other way, and Leah starts having kids again. Or she gets her maid, she follows the lead of Rachel, now gives her handmaid to Jacob and starts having kids by then. And she, in verse 11, she has a son through her handmaid and calls his name Gad. That means luck or fortune. Again, the idea of having another child. And then in verse 13, it says, Leah says, happy am I, the daughter will call me blessed. And she has another son through her handmaid and calls his name Asher. Asher means the same thing as Gad does, means good luck or fortune. Did I pass that over? That was wrestling. I'm sorry, that was the one that actually means wrestling. Any questions on those first 13 verses? Comments?
To me, it serves as like a real prime example, especially you see it with Rachel's misunderstanding of when people try to, you hear a lot of people, usually denominational background, talk about the sign from God, and they attribute different things to God. Well, Rachel is attributing her jealousy and the product of her jealousy to God. And she could not be any further from the truth.
Right.
And one child vindication is if God's vindicating her, but he's not. If he was vindicating her, he'd open her womb.
That's right. So again, just because the Bible records things that people say in Rachel's perspective that God was vindicating her for giving her handmaid to her husband, that's how she felt. Not necessarily the truth, but that's how she felt. Anything else?
The relationships between Zilpah, Bilhah, and Jacob different from Hagar and Abraham.
Are they different?
Well, Abraham took Hagar, she became a wife, but she was still the mother of Ishmael from the way of the...
True.
And here they're saying that's Rachel's determination that, yeah, she had the kid, but it's mine.
I never had thought about that. It might be something there. It might have been a possible. Again, I don't know.
A little tweak of the policy.
Yeah, right. Again, it was Sarah's idea, right? And she was trying to help fulfill the promise that was given to her and Abraham. So she would have thought, you know, again, because maybe she thought it was going to be Abraham's son. As long as it's Abraham's son, it's all that mattered. But again, it was pointed out that it's going to be y'all's son. So I don't know. But again, Ishmael is always referred to as Hagar. But here, it seems like Rachel and Leah are saying, these are our kids. Yes, they were had by another woman, but they're our kids. So, yeah. Next section is just bizarre. There's this weird stuff. Again, this interpersonal relationships are really strange. So I want to read 14 through 21.
Now Reuben went in the days of a wheat harvest and found a man in the field and brought them to his mother Leah. And Rachel said to Leah, please give me some of your son's man grace. But she said to her, it is a small matter that you have taken away from my husband. Will you take away my son's mandrakes also? And Rachel said, therefore, I will lie with you tonight for your son's mandrakes. When Jacob came out of the field in the evening, Leah went out to meet him and said, you must come into me, for I have surely hired you with my son's mandrakes. And he lay with her that night. And God listened to Leah, and she conceived and bore Jacob a fifth son. Leah said, God has given me my wages, because I have given my maid to my husband. So she called his name Issachar. Then Leah conceived again, and bore Jacob a sixth son. And Leah said, God has endowed me with a good endowment. Now my husband will dwell with me, because I have borne him six sons. So she called his name Zebulun. Afterward, she bore a daughter, and called her name Dinah.
So yeah. Does anybody have a different word than mandrakes in there, or a description of what that is? This says fruit, or that's the description you have? Does anybody know what mandrakes are? I brought this up to Cody at camp unbeknownst. We're going to be here, and him and Luke Norman thought I was a crazy person. Does yours not say mandrakes there, Cody?
It does.
I noticed that it's for fertility.
Yeah. It had the idea of being to aid in conception or fertility. That's what they thought. So, okay, here's a scenario, right? We're pretty far down the line because in the last chapter, Reuben was the first son born, right? So he's out in the field doing some stuff. So he's older now. And there's also been several children born. So we're down the line several years here, right? So Reuben goes out in the field in the days of harvest and he finds these mandrakes and he brings them to his mother. Rachel sees it. So were Rachel and Leah always watching one another, seeing what's going on? Oh, yeah. So she sees it. When she sees the mandrakes, because of what they believe, how they help with fertility, how they help conception, whether they did or not, I have no idea, but that was the belief. She wanted them, right? Again, the idea of children being all important. Is Leah going to give them to her?
Not for sure.
No, she's not going to give them to her. There's no way, right? And look at verse 15. Again, what is always the root cause of all these issues? What does she say? She goes, is it a small thing that thou hast taken my husband? So again, Leah was the first wife. She got that 1 week. And by, again, we're taking by implication, who does it appear that Jacob spends the majority of his time with? Rachel. He's with Rachel. That's who he wanted to begin with, right? That's who he loved more. So she goes, is it such a small thing that you already taken my husband? You want to take my son's mandrakes as well? And then what brilliant idea does Rachel come up with? She trades her husband for a night to get Leah's son's mandrakes.
Where is he
going? And poor Jacob. When Jacob comes into the field, he's like, what? Yeah, okay, whatever. He's all beat down after he's working. But it's this bizarre stuff that, to me, that's going on. So 16, Jacob comes out of the field, and Leah goes out to meet him, all excited, and she goes, you have to come in to me tonight, for surely I have hired thee with my son's mandrakes. Bought and sold, right? Nothing recorded of Jacob's response, but again, it's just, to me, it's just weird. So he goes home with her tonight, and he sleeps with her tonight. 17, it says, God hearkened unto Leah, and she conceived, and she's going to bear a son. So what did Rachel want? Rachel wanted the mandrakes because of the promise of fertility through them, and wanted to do it, and was willing to barter with her husband. And what happens to her? Leah gets pregnant again. And so this, again, you're just like, backfires in her face. And then what Leah says in 18, again, is to me is maybe kind of what Cody was alluding to with Rachel thinking she was vindicated. Leah says, God hath given me my hire, because I had given my maiden unto my husband, and she called his name Issachar. So why does it, at least how it reads there, why does Leah think she's being rewarded? It doesn't allude to the manner. It talks about her maiden, which to me would have been her handmaid that she had given to Jacob to have additional kids. So again, what's being recorded is the woman's thought process. But it's not necessarily right. Rachel wasn't being vindicated because she was doing things the right way. Leah necessarily not being rewarded with children because she had given her handmaid to Jacob. But again, there's just all kinds of confusion going on why these kids are coming about. And she calls the son in 18 Issachar, which means reward. She thinks she's being rewarded for what she has done. And then it kind of concludes with the same thought we've been talking about, verse 20. And Leah said, God hath endued me with a good dowry. Again, maybe to Katie's point, she's having all these sons that are going to take care of her and be her security as she gets older. But the main reason comes back to, now will my husband dwell with me. She wants her husband to stay with her, and apparently he is not, because I've borne him 6 sons. And she called his name Zebulun, which actually means dwelling. Anything else in those sections? Again, just bizarre, but we're getting just a glimpse of kind of those interpersonal relationships there.
It's like Rachel's plan there basically blew up in her face, because the whole reason she's trading for the mandrakes is to get some so she can have kids.
Yep.
But then Leah's like, okay, well, I'm going to take some myself. I'm going to have 2 kids, and then...
And it's even stranger because Leah had left off having kids, and that's why she substituted her handmaid and has a few kids, and now comes back and Leah's having more children herself. And so you would think, again, with Rachel, from what we're gleaning from her, she was upset and jealous of what was going on to begin with, because Leah had her own kids, she substitutes her handmaid, Leah stops having kids, she substitutes her handmaid, has more, and now, oh my goodness, Leah is having more children herself. Unbelievable, right? And maybe the thought process too is, you know, Leah's doing all this because she wants Jacob to live with her. Maybe Rachel thinks that's a very real threat. If she keeps on having kids, Jacob, because again, going back to Abraham with Ishmael, when he is forced to send Ishmael away, was he, and Hagar, was he excited about that? Did he want to do that? No. And that was his son. And so that heart turning right there could be a very, very real thing. And Rachel's concerned about it. It then mentions in verse 21 that after she had that, she had a daughter named Dinah. There was also other daughters that aren't listed. If you go, when we get to chapters 37 and 46, there's going to be plural daughters mentioned in that. So there was, again, because of the importance of the male children, they're listed by name and whatnot. There were some girls. Dinah is mentioned specifically, and that's going to cause a big problem here in a few chapters as well because of what happens to Dinah. Anything more in that section?
Also, the scriptures take the power of the mandrakes, and it's God that's sending children.
Yes.
The mandrakes came into play, but
you're going to see some stuff with the mandrakes, and also later, if we get to it, about the sticks they're going to use and the breeding of cattle and stuff. Now, the question is, do the sticks have anything to do with it? Was that the thought process? Was that something that God told them to do, like marching around Jerusalem seven times? Did that have anything to do with the walls falling down? Not physically, right, but there's obedience. Maybe God told them, hey, you do this. This is what's going to happen. I don't know. But there's could be some things and belief systems they have that don't necessarily have anything to do with reality. That's what they believe. Anything else? All right. Let's read. That's another long one. Let's read the shorter verse. Let's do 22 through 24. Just the three verses there.
And God remembered Rachel, and God hearkened to her and opened her womb. And she conceived and bare a son, and said, God hath taken away my reproach. And she called his name Joseph, and said, the Lord shall add to me another son.
So finally, what happened after all this? Rachel gets to have a son, right? And it's going to be one. It's going to be the son who's going to take a prominent role in the story going forward, right? The history going forward. Again, you would think, if you were just reading the Bible, not knowing the end result of the story, and how much emphasis is going to be placed on Joseph, that is the main character, the main thought, the main emphasis. But again, going back to Leah, the fact that she had Judah, and that's who the Savior's going to be. Leah, to me, is the silent major role of this story right here. Anything else about Joseph? And that's what his name means there, about being added to. May he add, what Joseph means. Now a longer reading. I'm going to read 25 through 36.
As soon as Rachel had borne Joseph, Jacob said to Laban, send me away that I may go to my own home and country. Give me my wives and my children for whom I have served you, that I may go, for you know the service that I have given you. But Laban said to him, if I have found favor in your sight, I have learned by divination that the Lord has blessed me because of you. Name your wages, and I will give it. Jacob said to him, you know, or you yourself know how I have served you and how your livestock have fared with me. For you had little before I came, and has increased abundantly, and the Lord has blessed you wherever I turn. But now, when I shall provide for my own household, or when shall I provide for my own household also? He said, what shall I give you? Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. If you will do this for me, I will again pasture your flock and keep it. Let me pass through all your flock today, removing from it every speckled and spotted sheep and every black lamb, and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and they shall be my wages. So my honesty will answer for me later. When you come to look into my wages with you, every one that is not speckled and spotted among the goats and black among the lambs, if found with me, shall be counted stolen. Laban said, good, let it be as you have said. But But that day, Laban removed the male goats that were stripped and spotted, and the female goats that were speckled and spotted, everyone that had white on it, and every lamb that was black, and put them in charge of his sons. And he set a distance of 3 days' journey between himself and Jacob pastured the rest of Laban's flock.
Okay, thank you. Good long reading. DSV is a very strange word in verse 27. Mine doesn't have, what did you say, divination?
Yeah.
Mine's an experience. So basically, Jacob is getting ready to leave. And he's worked for Laban for a very long time, longer than 14 years now. Laban apparently didn't have a lot when he got there, but with Jacob taking care of everything, he's become a very rich man. And Jacob's point of view is like, hey, I've been working for you all this time. I've made you wealthy, but I don't have anything for my household. Now, I guess he didn't tell you he's getting ready to leave, but he goes, I want to have my own stuff. And he's going to come up with a plan. And Laban goes, that's fair. Verse 27, he says, for I have learned by King James' experience that the Lord has blessed me for thy sake. What's he saying there? Yeah. Even Laban, as crooked as he is, says, yeah, I realize God is with you and God is blessing me because God is with you. Who else? What's some other examples where we recognize that in the Bible just recently?
Abimelech
and Abraham. We recognize God is with you. So, you know, you do what you got to do. You protect us. You don't fight against us. There was another one too. Who was just born?
Joseph.
What's Pharaoh going to recognize? Yeah, he goes, you're in charge of everything because, you know, we're being blessed because of you. Was it Pharaoh or the Potiphar? Pharaoh. Actually, all of them, yeah. I guess you're there. So again, that's a godly biblical principle, right? God is going to bless those who are serving him, and even people in the world should be able to recognize that. Not necessarily talking about wealth, but you are blessed, right? You're taken care of. So they start to negotiate wages, and this goes all the way back to when he first started working, when he first got there, when he worked for a month, and Laban goes, hey, you know, you shouldn't work for free, we're family, what should I pay you? And he negotiates, and then Laban, you know, messed him around on for his daughters there, and extorted more time out of him. And so Jacob comes up with a plan, and they might kind of lost in all of the ring neck and stripe, but basically, if you boil it all down, what is Jacob saying he wants?
All day long.
Apparently Laban's flocks were primarily solid color. His cattle, his sheep, everything. And basically he goes, Jacob, everything that is not of a solid, of this particular color, if it's spotted, if it's got, you know, ring sag, if it's this, he goes, that'll be mine. And so Laban's looking at his flock and going like, mainly this stuff, this is a good deal, right? He's not asking for a lot. He's asking just for the outskirts. So Laban's like, yeah, that seems fair. And it was fair, more than fair. The King James doesn't make it as clear what Laban does. At least I never noticed it with the way it used pronouns, but with ESV, it actually inserts the names. After he makes that deal with Jacob, what does he do immediately?
He gives it away.
So he makes that deal on one side with Jacob. Yes, you can have all those. He immediately goes over to his sons and say, go through all my flocks and pull all those animals out, then you all take them for yourself. That way, when Jacob shows up, what the few that should have been his are already gone. So again, it just shows you the character of Laban. Laban is, he's like Ebenezer Scrooge, right? He is a miser. He is a miserable person because he cannot make a fair deal. Even though in one side he says, I'm dealing with a godly person being blessed by God, let me see if I can mess him up. Right? Does he not understand who God is and that God is going to see that? And God's going to... Again,
He should understand that.
Again, if you go back to, again, King James in verse 20 says experience. If the ESV is right, if we know we are in a patriarchal period, if God is talking to Laban, Laban should recognize that. And with communication from God or just through experience and knowledge, because Laban's pretty old. Laban's been around for a while, right? He should have some world knowledge. He should understand. And yet, what do we see even today in the world? People can't get the idea of earthly wealth. yes, yes, I'm going to serve God unless I can take advantage of somebody financially in a situation, then I'm going to do that. Yes, you know, I promise to serve God, but if I can cheat on my taxes a little bit right here, then I'm going to do that as well. They're always concerned. They might, they say one thing or act one way, but it, when it comes down to it, watch their actions. They're concerned with this world. That's their primary concern. And that's what Laban's doing. Verse 33, Jacob says the very first part has a very unique or good phrase. What does he say about himself? Yep. Just in contrast to Laban's deceitfulness, Jacob says, basically, I know I'm making a bad deal here, but I know God is with me, and my uprightness will be shown forth in this deal. That's what he's saying. He goes, I'm going to live, even though I know you're not living integrity, I'm going to live integrity. And what you've seen before, with you being blessed with me, he goes, yeah, you're going to see it again.
Shows his trust.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Jacob has advanced a long ways, right? You go all the way back to whenever he deceived his father. Mm-hmm. Whose God was it then?
Your God.
Then he sees the vision of Jacob's ladder. And then what happens from there on? Oh yeah, he's seen it, right? This is a frightening place. I've seen God, I've seen this. And then things change for Jacob through his life. He's, you know, maturing to the point where, again, where God, even though he's been deceitful early on in his life and cheated his brother, he's dealing with people who are doing the same thing to him now. Again, we talked about the irony of those statements like, oh, you're cheating me, you're deceiving me. Yeah, kind of like, you know, you're getting back with some of the things you gave. So again, things are changing, but hopefully he's maturing, right? So again, Laban takes away the goats that should have been his and the cattle should have been his, and they separate three dirty, and Jacob agrees to continue to take care of the animals. Last little bit, so I'm going to read the last end of the chapter, 37th of the end.
And Jacob took him rods of green poplar and a basil and chestnut tree, and filled white stakes and straights in them, and made white ear which was in the rods. And he set the rods, which he had filled before the flocks in the gutters, in the watering troughs, where the flocks came to drink, that they should conceive when they came to drink. And the flocks conceived before the rods, and brought forth cattle ring straight, speckled and spotted. And Jacob did separate the lambs, and set the faces of the flocks towards the ring straight, and all the ground the flocks of Laban. And he put his own flocks by themselves, and put them not into Laban's cattle. And it came to pass, whensoever the stronger cattle did conceive, that Jacob laid the rods before the eyes of the cattle in the gutters, that they might conceive among the rods. And when the cattle were feeble, he put them not in. So the feebler were Laban's, and the stronger Jacob's. And the man increased exceedingly, and had much cattle, and maidservants, and men servants, and camels, and donkeys.
All right. So again, this is a very unusual passage. And actually, and doing a little research on the side, it's a passage that people use to ridicule the Bible. They say the Bible is full of fairy tales and things that are made up. Because what is he doing? He's taking these rods and branches of different trees, and he's peeling them and putting stripes in them, and he's putting them in front of the water troughs where the cattle are coming in to be watered, where they're going to be bred and stuff. And so if you, on a cursory reading, it reads like, oh, because they're seeing these striped branches where they're showing the white with the bark, then they're producing striped and speckled offspring. So again, that's what the world says, the world making fun. What we don't know is, from reading the description, I can't tell exactly what's going on. I get a general sense of what's going on, but I don't know exactly what the sticks in the watering troughs, the animals being bred, is doing to produce these certain types of cattle.
Do you think he's fencing them in with the stakes?
It's possible. I mean, I even thought about, because it says he puts them in the gutters or in the water trough. I even thought about last night, I didn't find anything to back this up, that maybe he was putting those branches in the water when they were coming to drink, that was slowing them down while they were drinking, which allowed more time for them to be bred. I don't know. He could have been segregating them off. Again, the Bible doesn't tell us that information. So it's a couple of the possibility of things is, one, Jacob was going to be blessed, right? when we get into 31 next week, we're going to read that God is, I mean, God, that God is talking with Jacob about this event, about these events, about he, I saw visions of this. So God, again, patriarchal period, is talking to Jacob. So is it a possibility that, that God told him, hey, I want you to do this. I want you to go, you know, strike these marks and put them in when the cows that you want are there. So there's a possibility that it could have had nothing physical to do with what was happening. It was just simple obedience, right? Again, the illustration of go mark seven times around Jericho, once a day for 7 days and seven days. Nothing to do with the walls falling down except showing obedience. So it could have been something as simple as that. Or who knows, God could have been sharing with Jacob some things that there was something in the wood, there was something in the pattern, there was something, there could have been something there. But it does show, again, the idea of the knowledge of genetics, of things that are practiced in animal husbandry and selective breeding, that Jacob was intentionally going through and using his knowledge, whether experience or God-given, to produce the type of offspring he wanted. Anybody have any questions or thoughts or have seen anything different in there?
We just assured him his blessings by obedience to God.
Yeah. No doubt.
You didn't want to say this much.
And that to me is like the strongest point again, like that God is going to bless you and me, gonna bless us. But if God is gonna bless us, that means we can just sit back and do nothing? No, it requires something from us. God is always looking for a show of obedience, right? And that's again what the world has a problem with baptism. What is baptism when you boil it down? It's a show of obedience, is what it is. God says do this, the world goes, that doesn't make any sense of how going in that usually dirty baptistry up there is going to remove sins from my soul. That does not compute. That's what God said to do. No more than the dirty the river in Naaman, right? Doesn't make any sense. Go dip seven times. That doesn't make sense. There's cleaner rivers back home. Just do what I say. So maybe that's it. Thank y'all.